Welcome back to Proactive, where I'm talking now to Hector McNeil. He is the co-CEO, founder, and owner of HANetf, and it is great to have you back on the line, Hector. How have you been keeping since we last spoke?
Very good, thank you. Yeah, no, it's the Christmas break was fantastic, but straight back into the fire of the battle, really, so all good.
Absolutely right, yeah. Well, last time we spoke, you were mentioning that your uranium ETF has been performing superbly well. I think you even mentioned that it was the best performing thematic ETF in the entire world, which is quite some accolade, really, isn't it? So what's going on over there, and why do you think people are so keen on it?
Well, I think the uranium market's a fascinating one because I think the sort of paradigm has shifted in terms of nuclear power being seen as a negative to it now being seen as a positive in terms of the fact that it's the cleanest energy you can produce. The problem with a lot of renewable energies is, you know, you've got to make sure that the sun shines and the wind blows and the waves wave, right? You know, and with nuclear power, it's pretty static from that perspective. It doesn't rely on the environment and the weather. So it's a really good baseline for that. So at various different conferences last year, many countries from the US through to UK to Europe and beyond have said that they're going to be looking much further into the nuclear story. And then that drives the uranium prices. And uranium prices are, driven by supply issues. And, it's a very concentrated supply. And, places like Kazakhstan, have talked about supply issues, which has driven up the price of uranium. Problems with, obviously, supplying out of Russia, et cetera, et cetera. So ultimately, that's been a big driver. And Uranium, which is our uranium product, which just went through 300 million last week, and it's only been in the market for a little over a year, is 80% uranium miners and 20% physical uranium. So it's almost quite unique as a product that includes both the physical commodity and the miners themselves. So I think it's a great way to play that market. And the performance has been very much there as well. And we've already had another $25 million in this month alone, and we're expecting more as we go along. So yeah, very excited by that.
Yeah, I'm sure. One of the points people have been making here on Proactive when we've been talking to people involved in the uranium trade is that a lot of the confidence that they're feeling at the moment is to do with the fact that it's very hard to set up a new uranium mine quickly. And so the elevation in prices is something that appears, nobody could say for certain, obviously, that yeah, appears likely to be maintained just because it's so difficult to bring supply online quickly.
No, I think that's nailed on. I mean, most commodities, if you're getting them out of the ground, it's a 5-year gestation period to get them productive, right? So, and it's very hard to time that production with the markets. So obviously when the markets spike, it pretty much is only the supply that's going on at the moment. And we've seen not only that demand rise, but also, some of the big players in the market having problems with their production, which then squeezes the supply, but doesn't dampen the demand. So, totally right. It is very hard to turn the taps on when that happens. So same with gold, same with oil, when you're looking at new fields, so I think from that perspective, it is a major driver to it for sure.
Let's stay with the theme of bullish long-term picture as well. And we had an article, I think, in the Telegraph yesterday from a NATO general saying that he anticipates there being a genuine old-fashioned ground war between NATO and Russia within the next 20 years, which is certainly very alarming, but certainly confirms, I guess, the thesis which underlies your NATO ETF, doesn't it?
Yeah, no, it does. Unfortunately, we have a great strategy, which is the future of defense, which is, looking at industrial and cyber companies that affiliate with the NATO alliance and affiliates. And we built that product like that because it is a defensive alliance rather than being offensive, so we wouldn't have, Chinese and Russian companies in there. It purely is affiliated to NATO, and fantastically we got the ticker NATO, which I can never believe, but we've got that. So you're exactly right. I think, whether there is a war or isn't a war, what's clear is everyone has to prepare for it, I think, given the relative peace we've had, for the last 50 years, people have probably took their foot off the pedal a little bit in terms of their armed forces and supplies. We can get our whole army in Wembley now, right? Which is always amazes me. And we've spent a lot of money over recent years for things like aircraft carriers and destroyers, etc. But you know, quite what's quite clear is we're not prepared for a war in the UK. And I think pretty much that's across Europe. I mean, Poland has stated it wants to have the biggest army in Europe. It's currently got 150,000 troops. It wants to be 300,000, you know, because it's concerned because it's on the borders of Ukraine. We've seen that Sweden and Finland are trying to join NATO as we speak. You know, there's always speculation across Ukraine. And then obviously you've got the whole scenario in the US, you know, spending the money. They've got challenges in the Middle East at the moment. There's obviously areas around the Chinese Straits, you know, which, you know, is always a big question mark. I always wonder, it must be very difficult living in Japan when you're surrounded by Russia, North Korea and China, you know, and no wonder they've got the fourth largest navy in the world, right? So, you know, I think that the reality is that, you know, people are going to go well above that 2% requirement that on GDP that NATO has. UK is already talking about 3%, you know, and obviously if Trump gets in power, then, you know, obviously NATO is going to be under a lot of pressure to survive to meet that 2% as a minimum. So I think, you know, the world is very much clear that people are going to have to spend more money on arms. A lot of it's high technology, a lot of it's cyber warfare. I mean, even on the cyber warfare, you talk about a ground war. You know, we're already in a cyber war. You know, that's going on every day of the week. And, you know, that's a big, really interesting area. And NATO, over 50% of NATO's holdings are in the cyberspace. So yeah, no, I think unfortunately that's going to be a constant you know, thing in people's minds. And you know, NATO I think gives a really good hedge to people. Gold is a great, really good hedge for it as well. But I think NATO's a really good hedge for that sort of outcome in your portfolio. But even if there isn't a war, I think people are still going to prepare for one anyway.
Now, Hector, the last thing that I want to come on to today, as if we haven't talked about enough wonderfully cheerful topics already, is the tough start to the year that we've seen, especially for the FTSE 100. Wednesday, it took a real dive, especially, I think, down 1.5%. Really looking pretty green around the gills at the moment. But in a lot of my conversations with people around the market, I see that there are points of light out there. I think AI is growing well in London, a few other things as well. And my sense from what you're doing there is that you're very much in the more futuristic end of the London market for things. And so I wanted to get the sense of whether you guys are suffering from the fact that London seems to be a little bit underperforming at the moment, or if you even think that my whole hypothesis might be nonsense. What do you think?
Look, I think, I think you nailed on. I think, you know, London, I think, has been suffering a little bit, you know, by the, you know, pretty small rise in inflation last month, which I think was unexpected. A lot of it driven by, bizarrely enough, by duty on alcohol, which clearly has had an impact. You know, but I think the markets had gone for a good trot last year, you know, and I think maybe there's a little bit of profit taking, maybe a little bit softening. You know, there are some question marks over economic activity. I don't think the FTSE was purely a domestic story either. You know, there was some bit of a pullback globally as well. But, you know, I think, you know, I think we'll see that corrects itself pretty quickly. And I think, you know, inflation's coming down, interest rates will follow, you know, a bit more consumer confidence will come through. You know, I think where I think is interesting for clients is broadening out in the tech exposure. You know, I think growth equity is going to have a bit of a run this year. And I think they need to move away from the Magnificent Seven, you know, to a broader play. I mean, we have a equal weighted tech products, iTech and SKYY and Digi. You know, focus on the sort of mega trends, the cloud technology space. I think that's where you need to go. You need to go on an equal weighted basis where you're broadening out from just the massive companies. I mean, the ridiculous scenario now, Apple's bigger than the FTSE 100, right? So, you know, it's an index of its own in a way, is Apple. But so I think there's some areas to play there. But, you know, I just think it's a little bit of New Year's Eve hangover, maybe, you know, and but we'll see that recover pretty quickly, I think.
Well, that'll be great. We'll keep our eyes peeled, Hector. Thank you very much indeed for your time today. Best of luck out there. We'll catch you again very soon.
Thanks, Thomas. Really appreciate it.